Hey again, this is Kevin Kitchens with Once Upon a Game, and about to get the first turn here underway. Lock and load Normandy using the lock and load tactical solo system. A couple changes from the last video where I left it. One, I think, this unit was down over here, and I just felt, this is the German side, but I felt he would be better served closer to the objective than down here. This Vickers gun here has a 14 range and can cover a bigger area here. So, but since there's limited on number of units, I thought it'd be better to go ahead and let him get up there. The other thing is, I didn't want to come across as uber negative in my comments. I definitely want to give the system a fair shake, and I think I am. I know there's a lot of people who view solo very literally, and then there are those who can take a game like this and do take a game like this and just play it two player, playing both sides against themselves. So it seems like this is filling a niche kind of in between the two. A couple of the resources that I did not cover in detail that you get with this solo system. Showed the movement decision chart here. But there's also a flow chart for an AEO order example. So I'll help guide you through with this example card number one, and then it'll guide you through just kind of an understanding of what you got to do. So that's one additional feature you get. And then there's also the solo rule book, which describes the system, a lot of what I already showed you about choosing the posture. But they expanded this, and they have a walkthrough. The rules are actually about 13 pages. The optional rules of the event table and reshuffle. But then the walkthrough is a turn-by-turn walkthrough of a simulated scenario, you know, against the AI. So that does help explain some of the rules. Still leave some out, still explains where you have to make decisions for the AI, which is cool. But it does acknowledge that. It acknowledges that elsewhere in the book, there's rule 42 in Conflict of Heroes, which is use common sense, right? Well, here they move that way up front. So like here, the object is to provide you with a challenging game where all the options are unknown to the human player. So that is true. You don't know what's going to happen. You don't know which unit's going to be called into play. You don't know which unit's going to be, called upon to fire a move or whatever. So that does keep you, give you that variability of happening. But there is a rule. There it is, 3.2, use your head, soldier. It's not perfect. We'll most likely not play the game you would play. While playing the AO may make moves that cause you to scratch your head if you have the last word. If you think the AO's action is not in the best interest, use common sense to override the situation. So that's the rule 42 common sense rule from COH that's used here. But there's also, it also gives you other ways to use it, just to use the cards to like pick a unit to use, or use the cards to with the unit's action, but you control how it performs. You can do whatever you want. And those are all 100% valid. All right, so I'm going to start off the first turn. This, like I mentioned, is an 8-turn game. The British start with the initiative, which means the AEO starts with the initiative. They are defending this hex. They have control of it. I've got a red cube there to remind me of that. The Germans, who I'm controlling, will be trying to take over. that hex and control it at the end of eight turns. So I've got the defensive cards shuffled in to the extra cards, and we are going to go from there. Let's see what happens. So draw the first card. So, yep. All right, the A order. It's card number 35. Now, first thing we see is we have an event icon there. I'm going to go ahead and play with the events because it'll always mix things up. So you do events before you even work the orders. So let's do that. We need an 11 or higher, and an event will happen. So, roll those dice. 7. No event. Take those out. All right, so we're going to start working down through this order. So if the there's a unit within one hex of a player unit, you'll do these steps. There are not. If there are units within two, you'll do these steps. There are not. There isn't a third priority order. So now we go on down. There's only a lot of skipping here on the first few turns because nobody's actually moved or active. So let's see what we get. Shaken AEO closest to a player unit. There are no shaken AEO units, so we can skip that one. Highest firepower AEO closest to a player unit. Okay, so here we have the highest firepower unit closest to a player unit. Fire. Well, this is what I was saying in the previous video about with spotting, is none of the player units are currently spotted because they're not adjacent and they've done nothing yet. They've not moved or fired or revealed themselves. And since they're all behind, well behind a hedge, then the line of sight is blocked. There is no unit to fire at. So it's, you gotta read that as if closest to a player unit that could be fired at. Is the way I'm reading that. So, and to the next one, highest firepower AEO unit closest to a shaken player unit. Well, no shaken player units, so there's no movement. So then it says execute victory condition. So we are going to pull out. I'm going to use my version, as I showed, of the victory condition table. A little smaller. You get bigger ones in the box. Defensive posture, execute victory conditions. And you start as a defensive posture, so you work your way down it. Is there a player unit within three hexes of the victory conditions? No. Okay. The victory condition, the only victory condition is this one hex. So we'll do that. Is there an AEO within five hexes of a victory condition? Now, in this case, they are, because this guy here is technically within five hexes of a victory condition. But the way I'm interpreting this, and this is one of those things I could be wrong, is that being within five hexes of a victory condition that I can flip. In other words, I already control this. I don't have to do anything. Or the AEO already controls this. So he doesn't do anything to get that. So it should be like a changeable victory condition, in my opinion. So if there were two victory conditions and one I need to capture, then that would apply. But here, I don't need to just be backing up toward that thing just because this says to. Okay? Because if I say yes, it's going to be moved towards it. In which case, these guys would pack up and move back. And we don't want to do that. So that's the way I'm understanding it. As it's going to be a victory condition that I'm trying to change to my favor. Are there AEO units off the map? Here's another decision that I'm going to make. AEO technically does have a unit off the map, a sniper unit. But a sniper comes in with special rules, and I know there are some rules for that will come up on one of the flowcharts for a sniper. So essentially, this isn't a unit that moves onto the map. A sniper is placed onto the map. He kind of pops up in a setup area, so he can set up anywhere here on map 14. He's allowed to do. Sorry, the focus is kind of wonky here. So he can set up anywhere here on map 14, but that's a totally different setup, so it then kind of moving on. So again, I'm going to say no there. And let's see, are there AEO within line of sight of a victory condition hex? And again, this one is one that I think is backwards. Because here you're saying yes, then you're going to the next order on the card. If you say no, they're not within line of sight, move the AEO into line of sight or toward a hex. Okay, no, maybe that is right. Maybe that's this one. Maybe I'm backwards on this one. So, anyway, there is no victory condition hex that they need to deal with. They need to place or guard. They can actually already see them. So, I'm going to, again, assume that he doesn't need to move toward that hex. He's got it covered. It's behind him. He's protecting it. So, working through the flowchart we got here, and it says go to the next order. All right, I'm getting the chart out of the way. And we have the next order. Oh, that's the last order. So now what do we do? Well, if you look here at our flowchart, you start and you're reading this, and this is the example flowchart that it's our logic chart that it's using. And you work your way through it, and in order you do the secondary orders, which we did. If you're done and no action was taken, then the AEO will pass. So basically, hopefully the logic here is he's gonna keep these guys in reserve until there's something to do. And this is where everybody's gonna laugh because I'm probably not the best strategic player. But again, since I'm only playing myself, I don't care. I have a good time, and that's what matters. All right, so I got a stack here with a leader. And he has the deadly skill, which allows him to add a +1. I also mentioned in the previous video, this leader had the decisive skill, let him shoot a second time, but you can only use that once. All right, so I'm going to activate these guys in this hex. So I got the guys with the MG, they're 144s, and if you've not played before, that's their firepower, their range, and their speed. For the MG, the firepower is 2 with a 9 range. A little further away. So I want to protect my guys first and try to get them to start moving in the right direction. Alright, so I'm activating this unit here with the machine gun. He has a movement factor of 4. So he will carry his weapon. Pick them up on the plexiglass. I really hate plexiglass, but these maps sold, so they have kind of decreased. Anyway, so I got these guys. Alright, so I got 4. So I'm going to move 1, 4, 1 across the hedge. And moving into the wheat field is 2. So it's their 4 movement points. They're still out of line of sight. And we'll give them a moved marker. Alright, it's time for the new, do the next AEO. Draw. So let's pull that first card off the deck. Let's see what this gives us. All right, there is an event option at the bottom. So we'll roll. Minor rare, we have an event. And we have a 9. All right, so we do have an event. We're going to say the red is the first number and the green is the second number. And so we got a 61. It's a booby trap. Select a building hex with a multi man counter that is farthest from the last unit that conducted an action and conduct a booby trap attack. Booby trap uses a firepower of 0 plus 2d6 against all SMC and MMC units in the hex. Reading this here. After an event without a star, roll 1d6 on a 1 to 3. The event is played on or by the AEO on a 4 to 6. It is played on or by the player unit. Last unit taking action was here, obviously. Got it moved. And the unit closest to building hex, that is a player unit, is nobody. So I guess we'll just say that this event did not happen. Again, nobody is within 1, so skip it. Nobody's within 2, so we skip it. We skip this. Shaken AEO, there are no shaken AEOs. AO closest to a unit that just acted, could then fire. So this is the unit that just acted. The AO that's closest is this group here. But they can't see him, so it's as if it's not there, so that just doesn't count. AEO closest to a shaken unit, also fire, but there's no shaken units. Execute victory conditions. Now, in this case, we know from the last check of victory conditions that there are none that are going to apply because it's the same flowchart. And so the AI is going to pass again. So again, they're just sitting here waiting while I do something. Once this guy moves here, if these guys move into this hex here, they become visible immediately because they can be seen through the edge, and then this guy has a shot at them. And there are rules for the AI taking opportunity fire. And so there's an opportunity fire chart you have to consult. I think I'm going to move another one of these guys just to get them moving here. Take them and move them 1, 2, 3, 4. Try to get one more AI card here. All right, flip it, it's a defensive card. Doesn't mean anything, just tells you to bring them into play. Again, no ones, no twos, don't worry about it. AEO closest to a player unit fire. There are no player units that anybody can fire on. AO and a zero terrain modifier hex closest to a target. Do a dynamic move towards terrain with a positive terrain modifier moving towards a target. Well, none of the AIs are in zero target modifiers. They're all in buildings. And this one's in a forest or a light woods with a foxhole. So no zero terrain modifier. So it's basically just saying if you're in the open, get to cover, but moving towards a target. AEO farthest from a unit fire. Again, the one that would be farthest from a unit that can be fired at is nobody. So again, we get to the bottom of the card. So he's still just biding his time. So we're just going to take this group here and we're going to move him up. We can move them into this hex because they are not in line of sight. Excuse me, bouncing around there. They are not in line of sight of any British units. Get some moved markers here and put one up. So let's see what he does now. Okay, so we have an event. Draw of 10 or greater. And we roll to 7 for an event. So here we go. Fire within 1, within 2, not an option. Number of activatable AEOs less than activatable player units. A little typo there, no big deal. Okay. Activatable AEOs. We have the sniper. We have. Did forget about the sniper. Well, they made a mistake here with my Germans, because I could bring that sniper on, maybe. Let's see how this plays out. Because if the sniper were to come into this building and fire that way, I do believe that is targetable. Let's see. It's right down that hex side there. Let's look that one up. It's one of those funky weird rules. But let's go with the card for sure. Number of activatable AEOs less than the activatable player units. So I got one. Let's see. So we got 1, 2, 3. So it's a weapon. Yeah, so it's still 3. Technically 4. 5. And player me has 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Okay, so that's not the case. So they will pass because I have more units. Okay, so I think what I'm going to do here is I'm going to test that opportunity fire chart. And this stack here is three 164s, German units. And I'm going to send this one guy up here. All right, so he is in line of sight, however, of this guy. So let's go to that opportunity fire chart. Take a look. All right, so is a moving unit part of a stack? That is a no. So he has 4 movement points. He has moved, right now he's moved 2. He's moved 2 because he crossed the hedge and there. So he's 2 movement points. All right, multiple AAO MMC stuck together? No. Fire at the moving player unit with opportunity fire. Okay. All right, so he has moved, so therefore he has moved, so therefore he is spotted. So we'll mark him moved. Now he is going to take an opportunity fire attack. All right, so he gets a 1. Plus a 1, plus a die roll. All right, British roll a red. Okay, he gets a 5. So 5 plus 1 plus 1 is a 7 on his attack. All right, and then we do the defender fire, which is a die roll plus terrain modifier. So there is no terrain modifier, if I'm reading that correctly. It's a rude. So he just gets a die roll. So we have 7 against a 4. That is a hit, so the difference is a 3. And then we do a damage check, which is 1 die plus the difference. Plus leadership modifier, which there is none. So we got a difference of 3. Okay, so we got a 6. His morale is a 5. So, and because he is shaken, he has to stop in his tracks. And he was slipped to shaken. And the unit who did the opportunity fire now is marked with fire marker. So we're back to the AEO. And we're going to see what card we get. All right. We no icons at the bottom, so that's good. All right, nothing again in 1, nothing in 2. All right, now we got the execute counteractions. So let's see what we got here. Defensive posture, counteractions. Are there AEO units off the map? So how do we get the sniper? There's a way to get to sniper, I think. Are they units off the map? Yes. More off-board vehicles than multi-man counters? No. More than one multi-man counter off the map? No. Never multi-man counter. See, they're assuming that that's a multi-man counter. More off-board vehicles? No. All I got is a sniper. So when they come down here, it says, are there more than one multi-man counter? It's assuming that there's one multi-man counter under that. So let's just ignore that path and keep going. Good order AEO weapon teams. See, there is a unit off the map. So how am I supposed to get that sniper onto the map? There's somebody here about sniper. Are there snipers on the map available? Yes, no. Go to the next order. All right, let's just stop thinking it and
just follow through. Are there AI units off the map? Yes. More than that, no. More than one MMC off the map? Move the MMC onto the map.
Nothing takes me to next order. Yes, that's how I feel.
So I'm missing something here. I know I'm missing something. I have to be missing something. Sniper's not a multi-man counter, it's a single-man counter. Yep, so let me
come back to this and look that up. Okay, so I just looked it up and there's really nothing to specify anything that I found about a sniper. Being specifically, you know, added. So snipers in Mock and Leather, the way I interpret it, is they're basically these wild card units when the game first starts. I mean, they're essentially there. You bring them, the owning player can bring them on wherever they want. They can't ever move again. That's part of the problem. So when you bring them on, it's like they were always there to begin with. They can set up in any hex that the that side could have set up in during the turn, and then they're stuck there. So, well, I assume that they have to be brought in on the first turn. I guess in theory they could be brought in any time, since they can only be positioned once. I think I'm inferring that myself. So, right now the only units that they could probably hit. If I brought the sniper on, would not be these. Well, depending on where I put them, of course. This line, this fine line right here, is the map divider. Got another plexi, so they can start anywhere in this map 14. I mean, I could easily bring them out. This is here. But then when they're stacked with this guy, they lose their terrain, their double terrain modifier bonus. So you don't want to do that. And even that would give them a shot. Then I could stack them with them. They'd lose the bonus again. And then they would have a shot at this guy. But then that would be locking them into this position to only get a shot at that one guy this turn. So I think I'm going to do that guy is just going to leave him for now and not bring him out unless the rest of the orcs says so. Let's keep going with the orc. So the highest 5-power AEO closest to a player unit that just acted, fire. All right, well, there is no AEO. The AEO that is closest to here is this guy. This is the guy that just acted. All right, so this is the guy that's closest to him, but he can't do a fire, so he has to target. He definitely can't shoot here, and he cannot see them yet, and he does not have line of sight into this guy because of that hedge. So the next closest would be here, but none of these guys have line of sight yet. These guys are blocked by this building and this hedge as well. So, next choice is shaken AEO. There is no shaken AEO, so we skip that. Then we've got the highest 5-power AEO farthest from a player unit with the lowest terrain modifier. Again, none of these guys have a target right now. So then we have execute victory conditions. Again, we have all the victory. The AEO has all the victory hexes, which is only the one. So, player unit within 3 hexes, no. AEO within 5 hexes, There's nothing it needs to flip, so no. Are there 80 units off the map? Again, you're assuming, let's see, are there more vehicles? No. More than one? No. Move in the MMC. So this is all geared around moving in the MMC onto the map, not a sniper. So, say no. And AEO in the line of sight victory condition hex. Don't need to. And go next order. And then next order doesn't mean draw another card. Next order means next order on the card. And that is it. So we got through another card. And the AI is going to pass. In this case, the AEO has passed four times in a row. And they did do an opportunity fire once. So it seems to be playing like a real player would, in my opinion. So that's fine. It did seem a little unclear. The rules could probably be polished just a little bit. And as we've seen with Conflict of Heroes and their solo rules, they've come out with new versions quite regularly. So there's nothing wrong with that. Again, I have the utmost respect for what they're trying to do here. And having now seen, again, just over four cards, not a scientific sample or anything like that, but it definitely is flowing a lot better with those few caveats in there. And maybe that's why, again, like I said, it was me, not you, it's me. So again, I fully hope that you're watching this just to see what it is, and then you see that I'm reading the card and making stupid errors, and you go, well, you're forgetting the stupid errors and looking more at the system itself and making your own assessment. I'm just trying to show you this system that for most of you is kind of unknown. So, like I said, I hope to get through a couple of turns and go from there. So, back to the game. I'm going to have this guy here move alone. He's going to activate to move. He's going to move 1, 2, 3. We have line of sight to him. He does. Let's see. This stupid. Got one of these laser pointers from the army painter, and it has been a bit of a disappointment because it doesn't always work. And it's there and futz with it. And we'll just do an old-fashioned card thing, and I would say that that does have line of sight. Is a moon player unit part of a stack? No. Multiple AEO MMC stacked together? No. Fire at the moving player unit with opportunity fire. All right, British firing. Okay, you got a 2 plus 2 is a 4. Defender roll is no terrain modifier. And you got a 5, so it's not it. Let's see what we get here. Okay, again, nothing. So fire, no. And we're going to be back to counteraction, so there's going to be a lot of lather, rinse, repeat. Counteractions. Still no AO units that we can deal with. No line of sight on anything. Okay. So counteraction still produces nothing. Shaken AO, there are none. Shaken AO, there are none. AO closest to a player unit in zero terrain modifier hex or victory condition, he is going to move towards. Closest to a player unit in zero terrain modifier hex or a victory condition, he's going to move towards. All right. I didn't check that, but we have nothing at the bottom here. This one is, seems kind of goofy. Why is this guy going to move out of his relative safety to engage me? If there were a victory condition, like if we had taken it and he was having to move over there to take it, that would make sense. But why would he do that? And he would not. So this must be one of those common sense scenarios. Right? because I do not see anything in this order that makes sense. Is there a sniper? Fire a sniper. So technically, I guess a sniper is always on the map, right? He just hasn't popped his head up yet. So we could bring in the sniper. But the problem is, once we bring in the sniper, he cannot move. And once we bring in the sniper, he is stuck. But you know what? I think we're going to do it. I think we're going to go ahead and bring him into here. So Snipey Boy is going to come right here. Snipey Boy has a range of 8. He's going to come right down this spine. You can cross that and be able to hit that guy. So we're going to bring in the sniper and let him fire. And hope this is a wise move. All right. So with the sniper, it's a roll 2. 2 dice. Right? His firepower is 0, but he gets to roll 2 dice for his attack. So sniper fire. Sniper can only target one unit in the hex. There's only one. He attacks with 2 plus direct fire table. He gets the plus 1 for the moved marker. And that's it. So, and plus a 0 firepower. So roll those. Okay, so we got 4. Plus his 1 is a 5. And so we got a 5. And the defender gets 3. Okay, so 5 minus 3 is 2. So now we do a attack. Damage check. So we got a 2 difference. So we're going to roll 1 die and add the 2 difference. So we got 2 plus 2 is a 4 and a 4. And this guy, I believe it's not going to hit him. He's got 5 morale. So nothing happened. Sniper Boy fired. When the next turn opens up, that's going to get nasty. And they're in clear terrain, they're going to be insta-spot. But I gotta try to get there. Maybe I can just trick him in numbers here. But I think what I want to do is spread him out instead of leaving him stacked. So I'm gonna just activate this one guy. Give that a shot. See if that makes sense. So I'm activating just this one guy, and we're gonna say 1, 2, 3, 4. It's a mistake. 5. Trying to keep him out for me and Jason. So now the other thing that he gets to do. Did I give him a shot? I think I may have given him a shot there. Oops. No, that was smart killing. Picked up the... Hard to tell. Stupid laser will work. It'd be great. But when this guy got here and a clear line of sight for opportunity fire, and they are equipped with the Vickers, so it's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. They can fire with a range of 6, and the Vickers can fire with a range of 14, so they got a shot there. Okay, so we're looking now at, will this guy take this opportunity to fire a shot? Maybe he will, based on the memory, but let's go through the process all the same. Let's see. Moon player getting part of a stack? No.
multiple AEO MMCs stacked together. No, there's only one MMC. So we fired the moving PU to fire. Okay, so we got a 5 plus 5 is a 10. And he has no trigger modifier. He got a 4, so it's a 6. That is a damage check. It's plus 6. 5 plus 6 is an 11. And his morale is 5, so it's double. Good order MMZ. Gonna have casualties. So this German unit is a 164. It's an A164. It's gonna reduce to a 154 or a 054. And that, and we get an even, so it's gonna go to a 054. So the 164 is gonna come out. He's replaced with a 054, who is shaken, not stirred. And he is now under a moved marker, and he cannot finish his movement because he was impeded. This guy just comes off the board. That unit has been fired. Excellent. So we have our card. It's a defensive card, no actions, anything within one, no, two, no, counteractions. So the AAO has no units, except for the leader who is ineligible to attack. However, remember, he can, if he chooses to, he can spend his decisiveness and reuse this guy. I'm going to activate this guy, give him 4 movement, and he's going to go 1, 2, 3. And he's also moved, so that hex has a move marker, and we'll just leave it there because he can't move anymore. And we got to do this anyway in case there's an event, which there's not. And blah blah. Blah 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 blah. It is essentially going to be pass. These are units. To move things along, we'll go ahead and activate this group. And this is just 2 units, so we're going to move them together, and we're going to do double time movement to give us 6. And I might just try to be a little more strategic, and I'll move him as the example. Move everything else later, so we have 6 spaces. 1, 2, 3. Yeah, we're just going to go and put them up in here. So we're going to move all these guys up into here. And they'll be able to fire here, and they'll be able to fire here. So now the question is, they do have opportunity fire into that hex. This is probably the best time to use it. So, I believe we will go ahead and use it here. So we're gonna go ahead and spend, it would have done an opportunity fire. And this is one of those things, I guess, where I have to make the decision. It actually comes down to, technically they are moving as part of a stack. So you roll 1d6. Is the result bad? If it's odd, then you're going to opportunity fire. So I'll try to find an odd result. And we got an odd result. So they're going to do opportunity fire. So he's going to cash this in. So he's now indecisive. This fire marker gets removed. We're going to fire the same thing we had last time. All right, so we're going to do the attack. We have a 5 hitting on that moving stack. So, all right, so we got a 2, it's a 7 on the attack, and a 4 on the defense. So we got a 3. So we do have a hit. So we do damage check on each unit. And we'll start with the leader.
he has a 7 morale. So we had a plus 3 difference. 7, 4, yeah, 3.
Okay, so off camera I did the resolution of the attack. It was a hit. The leader wasn't affected. The unit, however, was reduced but shaken from the attack. And that's where that is going to go the next turn. Hopefully he'll be able to rally, because what I hope to do was have that machine gun set up. We're going to fire through the hedges and hit these guys. So that is actually the end of the first turn, because nobody has any units left to activate. Now you got a fire marker. He was fired again. And cool. So we'll set up and take care of turn 2 on the next recording.